The next item on the order paper is a motion on the Historical Institutional Abuse Inquiry Report. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. I will ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this Assembly welcomes the publication of the report of the Historical Institutional Abuse Inquiry under its chair, Sir Anthony Hart, notes his recommendations for redress for victims and survivors of institutional abuse, and deplores that political impasse means that the report is not being actioned.
Gur Margaret, and I call Mike Nesbitt to move the motion.
Principal Deputy Speaker, thank you very much indeed. The inquiry was one of the first major acts, I believe, of the Executive in the last mandate, and actually represents these institutions working at their best. The Executive took a decision to do something about some vulnerable people who had been badly abused over a long period of time. They brought forward proposals to their, we often call it scrutiny committee, the statutory committee, but actually we know that the role of the statutory committee is to assist and advise ministers. And the committee took a consensual view across the five main parties that there were things that could be improved in the draft legislation, particularly the date at which Sir Anthony started to look at issues. The original proposal was 1945, the start of the health service. We said we should go back to the start of the state. And that was accepted by the Executive Office, or OFM, DFM, as was. And I think I heard Sir Anthony say that that meant 8 people came forward who would not have been able to come forward had the Executive stuck with the 1945 date. And the other thing, just reflecting on participatory politics, which was brought up in the last debate, was that we felt that it was wrong that it was only institutional abuse. On this basis, the same abuser could abuse boy A in an institutional setting in the morning, and then boy B in a domestic setting in the afternoon. Boy A would have access to the inquiry, but boy B would not. Even though it was the same man, perhaps committing the same abuse, but the differential was where it happened. That's not equality. And we were arguing that point when some of the victims of institutional abuse and their supporters came to us, and they said, yes, we get it, but please do not halt the progress towards this inquiry being set up, because we have been waiting a long time for it. Let this inquiry begin and then do something for those who will not have access to it because their abuse did not take place in an institution. And we listened, and we said, fair enough, we'll let this go ahead. So on Friday, along with some other MLAs, I was in the hotel in South Belfast when Sir Anthony made his report. And I listened to him talking about systemic failures, about irresponsible decisions, about homes with insufficient staff levels, staff inadequately trained. And I heard him talk about consistently these organisations who ran the institutions where the abuse occurred, prioritising the reputation of their institutions over the welfare of the children they were supposed to protect. And there was one word he repeated and he repeated and he repeated. The word systemic or systematic was used by Sir Anthony Hart last Friday, 41 times. 41 times he identified systemic failures. Imagine sitting in that hotel room, a victim and survivor of that abuse, and hearing 41 times a reference to systemic failures. Is it any wonder those victims and survivors emerged from that hotel saying they felt vindicated? As a commissioner in the Commission for Troubles Victims, I listened to a lot of victims, and there was a common theme When the horrible event happened, there was an expectation that the state and the agencies of the state would form the wagons in a circle, and anything they needed would be provided. Needed to get their children to school, needed some health issue, needed some money, the state would look after them. And the experience was quite the opposite. In this case, the institutions were the wagons. These children, through no fault of their own, were placed in care, and the expectation was that they would be nurtured and protected and loved. But the experience was that they were abused sexually, mentally, psychologically. In this motion, we're saying let us note the recommendations of Sir Anthony, but of course this motion was penned before we knew what those recommendations were. And now we know. Apologies and a memorial and help and financial redress. And I would simply say to colleagues in this House, who are we to gainsay Sir Anthony Hart? Who are we to say, let us have a debate about the level of compensation? Let's remember, today is yesterday and tomorrow, we are wasting £85,000 of public money because of that renewable heat debacle. So if we need to find money for these victims and survivors, let us simply commit to finding it. And let us also remember that this is intergenerational. And we are talking about people who have been denied opportunities, who have lost opportunities in life for employment, for education, for holidays, and above all, for social inclusion and for the creation of solid families built on love and all the values that you and I endure and enjoy. Huge lost opportunities. So we must do what we can for them. But you know, Tantalus-like, that report, which they have waited for decades, is now just out of reach, because the report was commissioned by OFM, DFM, and Sir Anthony presented it to the Executive Office. And to all intents and purposes, for the victims and survivors of institutional abuse, that office is shut. And that, Deputy Speaker, is the ultimate obscenity about the failure in Stormont Castle after 10 years of those two parties. Now, the Committee of the Executive Office has written to the Head of the Civil Service asking him, is there any way that report could be retrieved from the Executive Office and passed either to communities or to justice for actioning? I fear the answer is no, but I think we are right to ask. And I am also hearing that after the 2nd of March, 90 MLAs will be returned, but an executive is unlikely to be formed. I'm hearing word that we could be in for a long period of suspension. But surely, Deputy Speaker, surely the 90 who come back, if the head of the civil service can't do this before dissolution or during the period we're in election mode, surely the 90 who come back can find a way of actioning the recommendations for people across the divide who were abused through no fault of their own and have waited decades for us to act on their behalf. Surely there's a way. We can do just that and prioritise the people over our own squabbles and disagreements. Sir Anthony went through a long list of institutions on Friday, institutions run by churches and by charities. But he also talked about failures by other organisations, the police, the Ministry of Home Affairs, as was in the old Stormont setup, the Department of Health, local government, and some statutory institutions. And we know within his recommendations he has called for apologies. So, Deputy Speaker, let me say this. In conclusion, if it is the case that any unionist politician or any unionist minister in any way added to or failed to prevent the abuse and the suffering in those institutional settings. I offer my and my party's unconditional apology.
Thank you. I call Mr. Edwin Poots.
Deputy Speaker, I appreciate the opportunity to speak on this very important issue, and I welcome the fact that it has been brought forward and congratulate the mover of the motion in bringing it forward. Around 5 years ago, someone called into my office and related stories of what was going on in Rathgale, both at that time and indeed in the past. And ever since then, I've been working with victims of institutional abuse to try to get justice, and I welcome the fact that the inquiry was set up. Could I commend Sir Anthony Hart and the work that he done? I don't know how he sat and listened to the stories day after day after day, but he did, and he did it in a very fair way. But I want to congratulate, more importantly, the people who told their stories at that inquiry, because for many of them, it took them back to the circumstances of what had happened in the first instance, and it was hugely traumatic. If I can relate a couple of stories very briefly, because we haven't got time to either give the stories justice, or indeed tell them in full, or tell them as well as the people themselves. But young lad in Rathgale, not sleeping well at nights and so forth, a few problems, taken out at 6:30 in the morning and made to jump off the pier into cold, icy water. Caused huge flashbacks for that individual, and they ultimately had an early death as a result of it. Young girl got into the Sisters of Nazareth, 8 years of age, from 8 years of age. She was sexually abused by the priest who was supposed to be looking after confession. She was made to clean the toilets out with her bare hands, to carry the faeces out of the blocked toilets with her bare hands, made to bath in bleach after a priest had abused her. And that is the scale of what was happening to children in our society, in this Western civilized country, not 100 years ago or 200 years ago, 20, 30, 40 years ago. So it was right that the victims had their voice, and it's right that that voice is heard, and it's right that is acted upon. I think it is immensely regrettable that we do not have an Office of First and Deputy First Minister functioning so that we can respond to the Hart report. I think it's absolutely critical, and I'd appeal to everybody in this House. We are in an election now, and the die is cast, so that's that. But I would appeal to everybody in this House that we get round the table and we get things resolved quickly. I don't mean over months, I mean over weeks. We get things resolved quickly and we get back to dealing with issues like this. Because, you know, if you're talking about equality, here's people who need equality. Where's the fairness in the victims not having their voice heard, not having a response made to them on these important issues? Lord Justice Hart made a series of recommendations. Some of them are about finance. I think that we'll have to get our heads together and look at all of those issues, seek to respond to it as quickly as possible. But what I'm absolutely clear about is that Ireland, north and south, has a mark of shame on it as a result of abuse of children by a range of people from various organisations. I want a line drawn under this where we give the victims the recognition and we take every step possible to ensure that new victims do not appear. Our social care system has improved dramatically, but I don't believe for one instance that we have taken every circumstance out where a child cannot be abused. But let us have a zero tolerance of child abuse in this society, because for far too long, people turned a blind eye.
people covered it up. People actually created the circumstances where child abusers could go from one place to another to carry out that abuse. And that is just wrong, and ways of society can do so much better. And I appeal to this Assembly to give the victims all of the support that they possibly can in getting the resolution to these issues and drawing this line over this very important issue. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. I call Linda Dillon.
Gormugat. Firstly, I'd like to acknowledge that obviously some of the victims and survivors are here with us tonight, and I suppose first of all to say they've had a long wait to get here because obviously this debate was to happen a lot earlier in the day, but given the wait they've had to get to the point where they have a report and have some acknowledgement, I'm sure that it probably is a very short wait in comparison. Just first of all, I suppose I was at the launch of the report on Friday, and I think that the feeling within the room, or I felt coming out of it and speaking to some of the people, was really the important thing for them was the acknowledgement. It was the recognition, and has been said by previous speakers, that they were the innocent victims, that they hadn't done anything wrong, and finally there was some acknowledgement that there were people that did do something wrong and did it to them. And it was done by the very people who were supposed to care for them and protect them, as a parent would. And I don't think that there are very many parents that would do to children what was done on these children in these institutions. I certainly hope there aren't. Speaking as someone who has a close personal connection to the issue, I have some understanding of what it means to the victims and survivors, as my husband's mummy, Patsy, whom I was extremely close to, suffered at the hands of nuns within one of these institutions in Nazareth House in Belfast from the age of 4 years to 8 years old. I'm not going to go into any details about the story because it's her story, not mine, and she is no longer with us. But I'm well aware of how she suffered and how her sisters, her three sisters, suffered with her. In fact, one of them died in the institution and didn't make it out. And I feel that some acknowledgement needs to be given also to those who never made it out of these institutions, to those who died within the institutions, and I think that there probably is a failing in not recognising those, and I wish to acknowledge those today because some of them, some of their brothers and sisters and family members will still be with us. I actually spoke to Jared and his sisters before I mentioned this here tonight because I think that, as I say, it was her story, they're her children. They understand the impact that it had on her throughout her life, and I think that's very personal to a family, and I wouldn't have spoke about her tonight without their permission. And whilst they were very emotional, they said, our mummy did nothing wrong. She has nothing to be ashamed of. I think this needs to be exposed and it needs to be talked about. And thank goodness for Anthony Hart's report. It is being exposed and is being talked about. And all of the things that happened to these children, and as has already been said, the systemic failures that failed the children and that failed their families as well, because these children grew up and had families, and the impact was not just on the individual, the impact was on their families. It is generational. It didn't end with that one person who suffered the abuse. And I'm glad to see these victims and survivors being acknowledged. The abuse suffered by the victims and survivors, as you would expect, left its mark, impacted on their lives, impacted on the lives of their families. And again, I welcome that the report acknowledges this and that there are recommendations within the report to address it. I also welcome the recommendation that there be financial redress for victims and survivors. And I think it needs to be made clear that this isn't about compensation. This is about allowing these people to get access to services that they may not otherwise be able to get access to. It's an acknowledgement that a lot of them didn't get the education that they should have got. It's an acknowledgement that they suffered hardship in adulthood because of the things that happened to them as children. The motion outlines the fact that the current political situation may delay the implementation of the recommendations. And whilst it cannot be denied that there is a knock-on effect of there being no executive office, and this is extremely regrettable, and there's no one who tried harder to ensure that these political institutions remained in place and delivered for the people than Sinn Féin. And we will work day and night, and I hope that Edwin means what he says in this chamber here tonight, that we can all get round a table. And if there is a change of attitude, and if there is a real willingness to work and to work towards equality and to serve all of the people, we will be able to move this thing forward. But we all have to do it together, and there does have to be a change of attitude. But if what you say tonight in this chamber is true to your word, I'll take it at face value, and I hope that you are going to work honestly with us in terms of moving this forward.
Ask the member to conclude her remarks.
It is extremely unfortunate that we're in this position, but I have been assured by the Finance Minister that some of the recommendations can be acted upon and that he will be working.
Thank you. Thank you. I call Claire Hannah.
Mr. Speaker, and I thank all those who have spoken as well. Like others, I attended the launch of the report on Friday and have spent some time since reading the report, and I think, like everybody there, it was just a very difficult few hours, and that's even for those of us who didn't live through those experiences. And it has to be said how much the strength and the dignity and determination of the campaigners came through on Friday, as it has done for many years. And I think it was just very clear that those experiences for a lot of people opened up decades of suffering, and it must have taken incredible bravery to be able to go to that inquiry and to tell your story, and that has to be commended, as well as Mr. Poot said, those who facilitated and worked in the inquiry as well. Friday's report is a very long time coming. It was actually my mother, Carmel Hannah, who proposed the motion here in 2009 to set up the inquiry over 7 long years ago, and that was obviously after many years of campaigning by the survivors. And she saw, and they saw then, the inquiry as being the next piece of the jigsaw after the Ryan report, which detailed grotesque and systematic abuse in over 200 institutions in the Republic. That report was a watershed moment, I think, in Irish politics, and led to a fundamental changing of the relationship between church and state, and set the ball rolling for some of the redress that's required here, and did provide some catharsis, I think, in society and in allowing people to have their story heard. The Hart report, like Ryan, is a horrifying account of so many children's lives being shattered. And I think I read it as a mum and as a Catholic, and I read it, like most people, just as a human. And what those children were put through is just an absolute inversion of the values that I think most people here will try to put into practice in their faith lives or in their home lives. And the thought that so many people who perpetrated that abuse did so when they were entrusted as faith institutions, it makes it all the more appalling, as was the evidence that in some cases, you know, congregations knew about the abuse and failed to stop it. And I'd be happy to.
I wonder, just since you have met many of the survivors and the victims, I wonder, just maybe it's worth asking tonight if you would agree with me that we all are in awe of the inspirational heroism of the survivors of this abuse. And in fact, in the meetings that I've had, I'm sure that the members had with many of the survivors and victims, their thirst for life, their redemptive qualities, their disinterest in revenge, their commitment to community, their strong faith, that all those things are actually great examples for all of us as we work on the many healing projects we're involved in.
I would agree with
Members
that, and I would agree,
minute.
Of course, that it's so important that people who've put all those qualities into the public discourse, that we let them know that they have been validated, but the redress that they're entitled to is delivered to them. And these were children who were entrusted into the care of the state and deprived of that very fundamental human need of love, as well as the systematic sexual abuse and physical abuse and psychological abuse that others have referred to. Justice Hart's recommendations were very clear and very reasonable, and it is important that we deliver on them as soon as possible, that a public apology is given by an executive and by those institutions involved, and that a memorial is built here, hopefully in the grounds, as I think a symbol of society's public and permanent repentance. And I can understand that that would be difficult for many survivors to come and see, but I think it is important as a reminder of that failure and that it can't happen again. Sir Anthony Hart made specific recommendations for practical provision as well in health and in education and in social support that many people will require, and the need for a commission to be in place and an advocate to make sure that those who can access that support need it. He also made recommendations for financial redress, and as others have said, literally no sum could compensate people for the life opportunities and for the happiness that were denied to them, but it is very long past time that they had some comfort and some security of that financial compensation. The publication of the report is a moment that survivors have waited too long for, and I do think the possibility that we will show them the answers and leave it out of reach for any longer is not acceptable. The state has let them down too many times before and can't continue to do so. And I think the publication and the direction of travel of the recommendations won't have come to a surprise to any of us. The executive commissioned the report, and I think the provisions should have been enacted, as should the proposals to widen the scope of inquiry into people who were abused in clerical settings outside of institutions, and those in mother and baby homes, which weren't in the scope of this institution. So, in finishing, commend absolutely those who had the bravery to tell their story, and I hope they do feel vindicated. But everybody in this chamber has to finish the job and deliver the redress and support that Sir Anthony Hart made clear they're entitled to.
Thank you. I call Paula Bradshaw.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I don't intend to speak for very long this evening. I think the time for talking is over. It's a time for action, implementation and healing. But I would like to put on record the absolute support of the Alliance Party for the recommendation in Sir Anthony Hart's inquiry report. I am particularly saddened for the victims of the abuse who have campaigned for justice with the utmost dignity and courage, that the executive has now collapsed and that we're heading into a needless election. And this inquiry report, along with many, many others, are left waiting urgent attention from the new executive when it gets up and running. When the victims and survivors of historical institutional abuse and their supporters came to Parliament buildings last June, and I had the pleasure of meeting with Margaret McGookin, who's in the gallery this evening, what they came to tell MLAs and their supporters was that Sir Anthony Hart's report was planning to include a recommendation for a process for redress. And it couldn't have been clearer that the most sensible course of action at that time would have been for the two executive parties to ensure that it was provided for within the programme for government and that an associated budget was included. So 8 months ago, it was clear that this report was going to come out in January, and that the chair of the inquiry was going to make this recommendation for redress, amongst other things. And if the structure and resources for redress had to be worked up behind the scenes, then instead of us debating the recommendations of the inquiry report this evening, we would be discussing our support for the programme of redress and its immediate implementation. And so it is to the shame of the executive parties who had the power and, more importantly, the opportunity over the last 8 months to make this happen. I don't want to make political points tonight, but I think we've wasted 8 months because we knew exactly what Sir Anthony Hart was going to recommend. So in conclusion, I'd like to put on record the thanks of the Alliance Party to Sir Anthony Hart. We appreciate his diligence and tenacity to produce such a balanced and fair report. And as well as the programme for redress, we support the recommendations for a public unconditional apology, the creation of the position of the Commissioner for Survivors of Institutional Child Abuse, and the delivery of a memorial. And I would ask members here, like, unlike so many other things here in Northern Ireland, let's not make the memorial a contentious issue. You know, the last thing we wanted to do is fight over where it's located, its format and other issues like that. So, members, on the far side of the election, it is incumbent upon each and every person re-elected to push for the recommendations of the report to be implemented immediately. The victims and survivors of this abuse have been let down time and again, and it's time for this to end. No more talking, time for action. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Mr. Christopher Stalford.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Mr. Deputy Speaker, along with other members, I sat in the Ramada Hotel. It's not called the Ramada anymore, but I sat in the hotel listening to the report as it was presented. And quite like my colleague Claire Hannah, I thought of three people actually going through my head, Trinity, Oliver and Cameron Stalford, my children. And I thought to myself, listening to a litany of failure, abuse, torture, how I would feel if my children had been subjected to it. And it's not that hard to imagine how this happened. These were children that were taken into care, maybe because the parents couldn't support each other, or couldn't support themselves. They were born outside of marriage. For whatever reason, they were taken into care. And this state handed over to sadists and rapists children to look after them. And some... Yes, I will.
Forgive me, I omitted to say when I was speaking of the work that Margaret and Marty and the Savia team done and their tenacious work in bringing this forward. And on the subject that he's talking about, would he agree with me that we have got some honesty, but we could also do with justice, and the PPS and the police should be pursuing the sadists that he is talking about?
I absolutely do. Thank you. I absolutely do agree with that. And I sat next to a man at the launch of the report, and he said to me, they tortured me and my brother. They beat us every day, and they shoved bars of soap into our mouth. That man was probably 10, 15 years older than me. And you could see when he was describing what had happened to him as a child that he was regressing in his mind back to what had been done to him so many years ago. He was still living with it all the years after he had left the church-run institution that he had been sent to. This was a litany of failure at every level of the state to ensure the good care of vulnerable children and young people. Almost everything that could have been done incorrectly was done incorrectly. The report presented by Sir Anthony Hart must be actioned. And I listened to some contributions. I didn't get involved in politics to bring shame upon myself or to let anybody down. I want to see this report actioned. I think it was right that we waited for the publication of it. None of us could have foreseen circumstances where there would not have been an executive to implement it. But I want to assure the member from my constituency that I want to see this report implemented every bit as much, if not more so, than you do. I'm involved in politics because I want to help people. In my time in the Executive Office Committee that was chaired by the leader of the Ulster Unionist Party, there was not one word of disagreement around these issues. We all recognise the seriousness of the situation and the gravity of the suffering that was inflicted upon people who should have been protected and who should have been looked after. No one has argued or had a disagreement about the nature of the memorial. I haven't heard a single person putting forward differing or disagreeing ideas on that. I want us, either in the grounds of this building or in this building, to have a memorial that reflects that this shame is an echo back to an era where children were cared for less, where the state took the vulnerable, the poor, and the children of the poor and just pushed them into the sidelines. For whatever reason, those that were entrusted with overseeing these institutions decided that it wasn't worth their time so to do. And here we are, a few generations later, tasked with, I can't say repairing the mess or cleaning up the mess, because that's not right, but tasked with helping those who have suffered. And I want to see devolution used to help those who have suffered. I believe that it's right that there should be an apology for the role that the state played. I believe that a memorial is a good idea, and I believe that financial redress is also called for. And whilst the state had a role and should have a role in putting together a financial package, let there be no doubt, the churches are some of the wealthiest organisations in this land in terms of the vast reserves of land and property that they sit upon. And any church that had a role in the systematic abuse of children should be made to use their assets to bring redress to the people who suffered under their care.
Members' time is up. Thank you, Mr. Pat Sheehan.
And I welcome the opportunity also to speak at this debate. And we welcome the findings of the Hart Report. And what's important in a general sense is that it acknowledges the hurt and the suffering of so many and the wrong done over many years. I suppose, like most of us, grew up in a happy family where our parents cared for us. When we had needs, they looked after us and they helped us. They ensured we got a good education. We were kept clean and tidy, and all the things that parents do. So I want to pay tribute to all the victims and survivors who came forward and shone a light on the abuse of children in care. You know, like others, I was also in the Crown Plaza Hotel listening to Anthony Hart read out his report. And it's the stuff of nightmares. And for the victims in all of these homes, it wasn't just a nightmare, it was reality for them. And I want to commend them for their courage in coming forward. And I have no doubt, there's absolutely no doubt in my mind, and I agree with Edwin Poots on this point, that we will never, probably never be able to completely eradicate abuse within the system. But future generations of children will be safer as a result of the actions that the victims and survivors have taken, and their determination to ensure that the truth was told. All of us with any leadership role in society or the community owe you a debt of gratitude, and I thank you for your relentless pursuit of justice for all of those who suffered in institutions. Your actions have exposed what Judge Hart described as systemic failures. And we also know that there are many victims who didn't or couldn't, more likely couldn't, come forward to give their testimony. And our thoughts should also be with them today. Sinn Féin wants the recommendations of the Historical Institutional Abuse Report to be implemented as soon as possible in order to address the needs of victims and survivors. The state and the institutions in question failed in their duty to protect vulnerable children in their care. And it's important that victims and survivors receive compensation for the abuse they suffered, as Judge Hart recommended. Of course, no amount...
Will the member take an intervention?
Sure.
Just wonder, would you agree with me that, and I'm the first person to say that the budgets are very, very tight, but that we will and must, as a government, whatever way this comes back, but certainly it's our intention today, and I've said this previously publicly, that we will fulfil our obligations to those who suffered or entitled now to complement the truth they've received, that the justice is redress. And as well as that, would he agree with me that despite straightened budgets, that there has to be a significant contribution from a future government, if there's to be a future government here, to meet their needs. And in that regard, I'm hoping next week to meet with Salvia, and some of our colleagues are here from Salvia, to start that discussion, because someone should start that discussion. It has to take place about the quantum involved here in terms of quantum involved in terms of the overall compensation, but also
that intervention should be short, gentlemen. To be fair to the
well, just then to ask we, that we, someone has to start the conversation about what the compensation will look like, what the overall quantum will be, but also someone has to start a conversation with the churches and institutions who also have to make a very, very significant contribution.
The member had an additional minute.
I thank the member for his intervention. Of course, I agree with everything he has said. And of course, no amount of money could compensate for the loss of one's childhood or one's innocence. But it is only right that any incoming executive should make funds available for compensation as an acknowledgement of the wrong that has been done and the suffering caused. But equally, the institutions and organisations responsible for the children under their care and who let them down should make funds available also. I sat for, I think it was around 2.5 hours in the room listening to Judge Hart, and I can only imagine the roller coaster ride it must have been for the victims and survivors sitting in the packed hall. And anyone who was there will be able to attest to the palpable level of emotion in the room. I spoke to a number of victims and their families afterwards, and the overwhelming mood was one of vindication. They had told their story, and in the beginning, no one listened, but they were relentless and persistent. They didn't give up. They have now been vindicated.
Ask the member to conclude his remarks.
Your fortitude, tenacity, and courage is an inspiration to us all.
Thank you. I call Mr. William Irwin.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Can I first of all say I fully welcome the publication of this report. I thank everyone involved, not least Sir Anthony Hart, in the setting up and the running of the process of the inquiry, and of the acknowledgement for him through to the publication of his final report. A huge tribute must also be paid to those many people who came forward to give their accounts of abuse. No one can be unmoved by the plight experienced by the victims of institutional abuse in Northern Ireland, and how it has profoundly affected their lives. It has clearly been a very detailed and thorough inquiry, and was fully supported by government in order that those tasked with the operation of the inquiry had all the necessary resources to enable the process of the inquiry to be wholly adequate and robust. The absolute focus must always remain on the victims and the actual impact this abuse has had on those many victims throughout the years. The effect of the abuse was not isolated only to the victim's time and the place where this abuse occurred. Leaving that institution did not mean the end of the suffering for the victims. These horrendous acts perpetrated against the vulnerable and the innocent have stayed with the victims to this day, and the memory of the abuse they lived through is a daily source of pain for them. An important aspect of this inquiry has been to use those victims so deeply, to give those victims so deeply and terribly affected by the abuse a voice, and to say to those victims that Northern Ireland recognises their pain and wants to help lessen that pain. This inquiry has been a very important process for the victims in this regard. Another tragedy is the ongoing trauma for the victims, is the fact that as children they were not listened to. This is really a very concerning fact, and especially given that what the inquiry has found. It is all the more terrible that young vulnerable children, when they needed assistance the most, they were pushed away, rejected and disbelieved. It is unacceptable enough that children suffered at all, let alone that they suffered. I will, yeah.
Member
member talks about children being pushed away, but the member agree with me, is absolutely astonishing and appalling. The children were literally shipped to the other side of the world, to Australia, where they could be abused by people who were supposed to be caring for them as well.
Can I thank the member for his intervention? And certainly, it is almost unbelievable that this happened, as one member said earlier, not that many years ago. It is unacceptable enough that children suffered at all, let alone that their suffering was disbelieved and their concerns minimised and dismissed. That is a shameful state of affairs. I fully support the publication of this report, and it is absolutely important that the recommendations of the report are carried forward. The fact that we now have a period of uncertainty with regards to the future of this Assembly is ridiculous, and that fault lies squarely with Sinn Féin, who for their own agenda have triggered an election only months after the previous poll. It certainly is deplorable that this long-awaited report has been delivered, and now this House cannot move to respond proactively to the recommendations. The victims deserve better, and Sinn Féin must face up to the knock-on effects of their decision to bring down this Assembly, a result of which has been to cause further upset to historical institutional abuse victims. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Mr. Roy Beggs.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. On Friday, survivors of historical institutional abuse had their day that many had waited decades on, a day of public recognition of their suffering. What happened to them was wrong. It should never have taken place and should have been picked up much, much earlier by investigations by various statutory bodies. Sir Anthony Hart and his team lifted the cover off the 73 shameful years in our history, in which some of the most vulnerable in our society, children, were exploited, degraded and abused by those who had been trusted to care for them. And I'll pick up what my party leader said earlier. Some 41 references in the report of systemic failure, system failure, which should not have happened, and that they should have been picked up. Some, as has been said by the member for South Belfast, were transported to the other side of the world alone, only to face further abuse. Those who survived to see Friday not only saw verbal recognition, but a list of concrete measures recommended by Sir Anthony Hart. They received recognition that the abuse they had suffered did not just affect their childhood. It scarred them and may have limited opportunities throughout their life. Had they been dealt a different set of circumstances, they could have walked another path of better educational, social and economic opportunities. And I would highlight that the suffering affected children from throughout Northern Ireland, including my own constituency. Adjacent to it, we have the Bonmore Children's Home, Bernardo's Masterton and the Sharnmore Project, each of which were investigated as part of the programme. Like other MLAs, I too have met an East Antrim constituent who had been placed on this occasion in Lisieux Hospital, who then attended the hearing to report the abuse that he had endured whilst under care. The package of recommended financial compensation recognises the long-term effect on the potential of these people and the abuse that they suffered. And it attempts to put right some of what was wrong by providing some financial certainty. I agree also that significant compensation should be sought from those bodies whose care these vulnerable young people had been placed. They too have a responsibility. But the judge also put in place a number of other measures that would create a legacy to prevent this from ever happening again, and that perhaps is the best legacy that all of us should ensure happens. A permanent memorial instalment to make sure that as legislators, those who suffered are always in our thoughts. A commissioner to advocate on behalf of survivors to ensure that their needs are met. But in the cruelest and most callous of twists, survivors find themselves able to see the end point, but not able to grasp it. Why? Because of the toxic politics of this executive. We enter an election period without the full publication of the report, without even a 2017-18 budget in place to address the recommendations for compensation. I've heard victims on the radio and TV who have now finally, who should now have finally some certainty, expressing their frustration, but they have anything but certainty. The recommendations made by the Historical Institutional Abuse Inquiry are now left in limbo, have been handed to the Executive Office at a time when we don't have a First or Deputy First Minister in place to take them forward. And indeed, there is no one sitting in the ministerial chair tonight to respond to this debate and to say what is going to happen. What a legacy are we as Assembly and politicians giving? And there will be an onus on those who come after this election to make sure that something is put in place to deliver to the needs of these vulnerable people. So I would appear to what remains of the Executive in the coming days to do one thing, to be honest. Survivors have walked a long road where their hopes have been repeatedly been raised and then dashed. They ought to be honest with survivors. Tell them what you can and cannot deliver. Finally, as an Assembly, it's important that we pause to recognise the strength of those who fought for this day, being forced to relive the terrible memories and to be re-traumatised. It was important that they did it in order that lessons can be learned and to ensure that it does not happen again. And I salute the courage of those who provided evidence and have contributed to these recommendations. Thank you.
Thank you, the members. I call Pam Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. And obviously this motion starts by welcoming the publication of the report of the Historical Institutional Abuse Inquiry. And Mr Deputy Speaker, it's a sad day that we are having to welcome such a report, but we all are, of course, giving our thanks to Sir Anthony Hart for the valuable work that he has done whilst chairing this inquiry. An inquiry into institutional abuse which is abhorrent in all right-thinking minds. This mistreatment and sexual abuse which took place within church and charitable organisations, which we all rightly expect to hold in high esteem and with much trust, is utterly deplorable and should be condemned by all in this Assembly, and that includes being present to see through any appropriate recommendations that follow this inquiry. The motion also speaks of noting the recommendations for redress for victims and survivors of institutional abuse, and no one could argue against that desire to see redress from these most innocent of victims, those who have had their childhood and indeed their lives destroyed by the most vile offenders, people who were put into positions of trust, who were to care for our children. And to quote my party colleague Christopher Stalford, I completely agree that the scale of failure to protect our most vulnerable children is astonishing, and that it does indeed represent a complete failure by the Ministry for Home Affairs, the DHSS and our criminal justice system. Children and young people were placed in these homes with a certainty that they would be well cared for, nurtured and looked after, particularly because of the regard charities and churches were held in. This is yet another example of some of the most heinous crimes that have been uncovered in Northern Ireland. Of course, we are not alone. We know the paedophiles in particular all across the globe will place themselves in positions of trust and of power in order to ensure they fulfil their own disgusting warped needs, and it is right and proper that we should be repulsed by their actions. The latter part of the motion speaks, of course, about deploring the political impasse, means that the report is not being actioned, and you'll certainly have no argument from me on that. The decision by the party opposite to pull down this government in order to fulfil their political wish list disgusts me. And we have recently seen again their lack of interest demonstrated by either empty or virtually empty seats. Election preparations are obviously well underway because they've decided to turn up today. We cannot ease the pain and anguish that the victims will never be free from, but it would at least show and demonstrate this government cares about their suffering and recognise fully the wrongs that were committed against these individuals if we took certain action on the back of this report. Mr Deputy Speaker, it is a very, very sad day when this government receives reports such as this and is unable or indeed unwilling, in the case of Sinn Féin, to give the attention and action that the victims of historical and institutional abuse deserve.
Thank you. I call Mr Chris Little.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Can I
welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate tonight and start by commending my Alliance colleague and member for South Belfast, Paula Bradshaw, MLA, for her contribution, which I think goes to the core of what the message that needs to be sent out here tonight. Given the gravity of the HIA inquiry report, it is now time for action. That, for me, is the key message being sent out this evening. There is no First Minister and Deputy First Minister. However, the victims and survivors and their supporters have been signposting the likely recommendations of this report for months, if not years. We do have a Health Minister, we do have a Justice Minister, and if the Executive Office were able to issue a statement in relation to this report on Friday, I would have liked to have think genuinely that one of those ministers could have been here this evening to respond to this extremely important debate, to provide some degree of update as to progress on those recommendations to the victims and survivors in our community and indeed those that are here tonight. Deputy Speaker, this has been one of the most challenging issues on which I have worked as an MLA. It has been a privilege to meet the victims and survivors and indeed the many people that have supported them along the way. Carmel Hannah has been mentioned. I think of Conal McDevitt as well, Patrick Corrigan of Amnesty International, and Professor Patricia Lundy of Ulster University, part of the panel of experts that has supported the victims and survivors. But it is the courage, the dignity, and the perseverance of those victims and survivors that has driven the campaign and progress towards the truth and redress that they deserve. And it is for those victims and survivors that I commend the work of the HIA inquiry led by Judge Hart and welcome the comprehensive recommendations that it has made. It did take a 2.5-hour statement, a 2,300-page report, 10 volumes, I believe, in total, to set out unequivocally how the inaction and action of state and church organisations with the responsibility to protect children and young people in our community instead expose them to the most heinous systematic institutional emotional, physical and sexual abuse. I would like to pay tribute to the victims and survivors of this abuse who have had to fight with courage and dignity to achieve the long overdue acknowledgement and truth that they deserve. Mr. Deputy Speaker, sitting at the launch of the report on Friday, one of those victims and survivors turned to me after every bit of detail that had been put forward and asked me simply, "Do you think that means that they believed us?" That was the most important issue to him, and I am glad that he has been believed in complete detail. But, Deputy Speaker, it is now absolutely crucial that the details of those recommendations, the public apologies, the memorial, the services to meet the individual needs of those victims and survivors, and the redress and compensation payment are actioned as a matter of urgency. And we do need to hear an update as to how that will be achieved. If it is the truth that these recommendations cannot be progressed in the absence of the executive, then victims and survivors deserve to hear that truth. But there is an urgent obligation to implement this report, and that alone should serve as reason for a functioning, power-sharing executive to be put back in place. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I would mention, as an MLA for East Belfast, the reference to Kinkora Boys Home in the report. The report found that Kinkora residents were exposed to numerous acts of sexual abuse of the gravest kind. Judge Hart did give reassurance that he had access to all information he required, but I do remain concerned by the fact that there were key individuals who appear to have not felt able to give oral evidence to this inquiry, and that does remain a concern. I would also acknowledge the ongoing need for investigation into the victims of clerical abuse outside of institutions and mother and baby home abuse as well. We need to hear what the executive has been doing to progress the need for truth and redress for those victims, and of course the moral obligation on all those in authority to deliver for the victims and the needs that they have. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Claire Bailey.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker.
And as someone who's worked for Nexus, an organisation who does work with the victims of sexual abuse and rape, I know fine well that this type of abuse has long-lasting and horrific consequences for victims and survivors. And more often than not, it takes decades, sometimes, for them to find the space to speak their voice and reach out for some help. We need to ensure that these types of organisations are properly funded in order that they can continue to offer this avenue of help for those who need it. It's impossible not to welcome this report. It's truly awful, as has been mentioned, that it's being debated in the environment where our government is crumbling by the day and our executive are not here to move forward on it. Because I believe that the victims and survivors deserve much more than a half-empty chamber and a non-existent executive in order to move forward with what I believe they've probably just started. But I do also share the concerns raised by Chris Little in terms of the Kinkora, the mention and those who didn't feel that they could come forward and take part in this investigation, and their reasons for doing so as well. But I want to try and offer a bit of hope to them that in having this report, this is just the first platform, this is the first step, and there's much more needs to be done and much more that we can be doing to help. I also think that the campaigners, they've done much more than wait for this report. They have fought and they have suffered and they have struggled to be believed and heard for most of their lives. And I also believe that this House has wasted much more than 8 months, because we have to acknowledge that we have wasted most of the victims' and survivors' lives in bringing this to where it is, and it's still not resolved. When we hear the words systemic failure, know that this institution is a major player in that system. I have so much untold admiration for the campaigners, and we can never again say that we don't know, that we didn't know, because we know. And we do need to say sorry, and I am deeply sorry. I'm also deeply sorry to every child in this country who's currently living with this fear and this abuse, and I want to do all I can to make sure that each and every one of them know that we are listening and we are going to take action and we are coming to an election. So when we go out with our pledges to the public, make this your number one, because this crime did not end in institutional abuse. This crime is prolific in our society. It is happening today, it will happen tomorrow, and it happened yesterday. This is our shame. And the real tragedy of all this is the fact that these victims are still not seeing justice, the justice that they deserve, because of the failures of this executive. Stormont is fast becoming a byword for corruption, and today its legacy of redress for these victims is certainly nothing to be proud of. This whole suffering is our entire shame.
I call Mr. Eamon McCann.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I want to say first that having sat here listening to this debate, there were one or two occasions when I felt a wee bit uneasy. And those were occasions when quite spirited attacks were made on the Sinn Féin Party for its actions, which contributed to the suspension of the Assembly, or the crumpling of the institutions. And the suggestion seems to be made that somehow Sinn Féin was less than wholehearted, or at least hadn't seemed to be fully wholehearted in handling this issue, because they had left with nowhere to go with it, the institutions are gone. I actually think it's to use this issue, and it was used, that was to use the issue in relation to a debate which is going on in this Assembly and in this society, which has got nothing to do with child abuse or anything like that. And it was simply inappropriate that members of the DUP over there should have made those points, and I think it's right that somebody other than a Sinn Féin member should stand up and say that, and I'm very pleased to say it. Let me say also that the singer Christy Moore wrote a song called In the Middle of the Island, started back in the 1980s. It had a refrain which she kept repeating. Everybody knew, nobody said. Everybody knew, nobody said. It wasn't about child abuse, but child abuse in a slightly different context. It was about a young woman, a girl called Anne Lovett, who in 1984, on a January day, came out of school sort of, and went to the grotto of Our Lady, O Clement, O Loving, O Sweet Virgin Mary, sort of the outskirts of Granard in the county of Longford, and lay down and gave birth. She was 15 years old. That was Christie's point. Everybody knew, nobody said. She suffered in silence. She gave birth. Of lying there, the child was born dead. She died within a couple of hours. So there's an example of the way, and the connection between that, the direct connection between that and what we're talking about. So it's that sort of the destruction of truth and honesty in relation to sex in our society as a contributory factor to all this. And I think that in some ways, sort of, in it, the understanding is absolutely right. Everybody has spoken compassionately about the victims of this here. You know, and you can't have an excess of compassion, but I'll tell you what, that sometimes it leads you to speak in a way which doesn't describe blame, which doesn't point the full blame to where it belongs. Now, we talk about the Christie and the everybody knew, nobody said. I mean, I can remember when I was growing up, Rossville Street in the Bogside. At one point, my mother decided we should be one of those family rosary families and say it every night. So we did, and she always read out, and only Catholics probably will understand this entirely. She'd go through, and every evening she'd say sort of the phrase, other people used it too, was the fifth decade of the rosary. We'll say this decade for the homeboys, God help them. That was the phrase. We'll say this decade for the homeboys, God help them. The homeboys were boys from the tenement back of home, just above the Letterkenny Road, on the outskirts of Derry. You used to see them. People talked in whispers about this. The homeboys, about the terrible things that were done to the homeboys. Everybody knew. Everybody knew. And they were decent, kind people. Why didn't they speak up? Here's the point I'm getting to. It was reverence for the Catholic Church combined with the oppressive power of the Catholic Church down upon them. The Catholic Church has an awful lot to answer for, and it's not just little individual incidents. It's because of that role and the way it was perceived sort of in society, and people were afraid to speak out. You didn't speak out against the priest. That's one of the reasons why clerical sex abuse sort of lasted for so long, and they got away with it. Now, the result was that when you had, for example, there's a woman called Peggy Gibson. She's from Deanery Street in Derry, now living in Queensland. The reason why she's living in Queensland is she was one of the kids exported from this country, north and south, mainly from the north, like in the Australian. Now, yes, how did that happen? How were a five-year-old child taken to Australia? One of the questions when I was writing about these things that came to me was, what travel documents were involved? Who gave permission? And actually, I finally got it. John McCourt, who's in the gallery there, finally came to me with a document which showed sort of what had happened. There was a priest signed a document certifying that a nun, a named nun, was in loco parentis and would have the authority to take this child away. The nun then signed, countersigned this. The Home Office in London approved it, and off they came. There you had sort of the entire thing. Sort of, this is a criminal conspiracy. The state was colluded in all that. The Catholic Church wanted we Catholics out in Australia to build them up. The Australian government wanted English-speaking white kids, the part of the white Australia a policy. And sadly, sir, nobody in authority in Northern Ireland in those days, sort of the Union estate, nobody was too worried about we Catholics disappearing from the Tiernan back of school. They disappeared, sort of. These people in the custody of the state. I could give you other examples, but I don't have time to do so.
Time is up.
Yes, we should do all the things that are said here. We also should draw certain conclusions about certain institutions.
Thank you. The member's time is up. Thank you. I call Mr. Richie McPhillips to wind up on the debate and the motion, and the member is up to 10 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. As a member of the Committee of the Executive Office, I welcome the opportunity to contribute to this evening's important debate, brought to the Assembly by non-executive parties concerning the publication of the Historical Inquiries Report. I would like to start by putting on the record my thanks to Sir Anthony Hart for conducting the report before us today, and I want to give my appreciation to all those individuals who worked as part of the Historical Inquiries team, which enabled the publication of this report that has provided vindication for so many victims. I would also like to take this opportunity to commend the many individuals and organisations who have tirelessly campaigned for justice for the victims of historical abuse. They have run a relentless campaign, and it's important that we give these people due recognition today. I know that for many victims of abuse, the giving of evidence would have been no easy feat, and I fully commend these people for engaging with the inquiry. Mr. Speaker, the publication of the HIEA report was long overdue. For survivors of these horrendous crimes, this report represented hope that they would see justice, that their accounts would be vindicated, that the conspiracy theories would be either verified or dispelled, and that the whole investigation would be conducted without prejudice. And I'm glad, Mr. Speaker, that this vindication has finally come to these survivors in a report that reveals evidence of systematic failings in the 22 state institutions and homes investigated and the unjustifiable sending of children to Australia for labour. The authorities failed many, many victims and individuals across the number of institutions, but most worryingly, the inquiry has found that these institutions were seemingly more concerned about their own reputations and protecting the perpetrators rather than looking for the best interests of some of the most vulnerable children in our society. These deliberate oversights, Mr. Speaker, enabled in many cases the continuing of the abuse to these children, and in hindsight, it begs the question, what impact would timely intervention have had on these cases? The failure of the authorities is a heinous crime in itself, and the state duly owes all those individuals impacted an apology. I am glad that various organisations investigated and found to be at fault have come forward over the past few days to offer such an apology. The report before us today, Mr. Speaker, makes clear recommendations, which includes the establishment of a commissioner for victims and survivors, as well as a much-needed tax-free compensation scheme. It also recommends the putting of a memorial in Stormont Gardens on grounds to respect those individuals who have been wronged by the state. These are welcome developments, along with other recommendations contained within the report. But Mr. Speaker, just as we get to the end line, after decades of long, long wait for these people for justice, that just in the same vein that redress has been achieved by the inquiry's report, it's been taken away from them due to the childish actions of those currently occupying what is meant to be the executive of the Northern Ireland Assembly. These individuals and families have suffered long enough, and it is issues of abuse that really put things into perspective as to where this Assembly is today and who we actually serve. It is now important that the recommendations made by and brought forward without hesitation in those, and the compensation scheme must be prioritised to give immediate redress. Following the election, the budgetary resources for the scheme must be found and those funds must be ring-fenced. We need that commitment from any future executive. Mr. Speaker, I now turn to some of the other members' comments. And I begin with the proposer of the motion, Mr. Mike Nesbitt. He highlighted, obviously, the 41 systematic failures in Sarantini's report. Claire Hanna, obviously her mother, was the first person to propose this motion and set up the inquiry and get it running. Paula Bradshaw, in her contribution, expressed the disappointment of the collapse of the executive. And it obviously means, as I've already pointed out myself, a future delay and a big disappointment that no redress programme was in place. Mr. Stalford mentioned about at the Executive Office Committee there was never any disagreement. That is true in one sense, but on a number of occasions, even personally, I asked the First and Deputy First Minister why there was no redress scheme or what was being done, and they basically kept saying that they were waiting on Sarantini's report. It's just a pity that nothing was put in place, because if it had been, we would have been able to action it now. Mr. Wright Beggs talked about the toxic nature of the politics here and obviously the legacy that we're sending out in terms of no minister present to take part in this debate. He also spoke about the victim report presentation to look to him for or Chris Little talked about a victim at the report looking for affirmation that his story was being believed. And in conclusion, Claire Bailey talked about the half-empty chamber, and I think that, in many respects, is very disappointing. I commend this motion to the House, and I also acknowledge some of the people that are here tonight for the debate, and I think it's unfortunate that they had to wait for so long to actually view the debate today. But I conclude, and thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Order. Thank you. And can I take the unusual step on behalf of the entire House want to acknowledge the presence and the dignity of those in the public gallery who have attended and listened to this debate. The question is that the motion standing on the order of paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Members, just before the adjournment, I wish to inform the Assembly, as required by Standing Order 79.4, that Mr. Ross Hussey has given notice of his resignation as a member of the Assembly Commission with immediate effect. Item 6 on the order paper, the adjournment. The question is that the Assembly do now adjourn. The Assembly is adjourned.